So today we are going to do this. We are going to do linear regression with model improvement strategies. That is, we have four different algorithms we are going to study: ridge regression, lasso regression, PLS, and PCR. Before studying that, we'll just see that what are the things which affect linear regression model. So first we'll see interactions in linear regression. What is the effect of interactions in linear regression? So in regression, an interaction effect exists when effect of an independent variable on a dependent variable changes depending on the values of one or more independent variable. So when we are using at least two variable as a predictor, and these two variables, interaction between these two variables have a collaborative effect on the target or the attribute variable, target output variable, then it is we say that interaction exists and it has a cumulative effect. Okay, so how do you know that? So here you can see the y equal to c, b0 is considered as c, then b1 is the first regression coefficient of the first variable x1, and b2 is the regression coefficient of the second variable x2, where y is the predicted value of a dependent variable, x and x1 and x2 are independent variables, and b0, beta, b1 and b2 are the regression coefficients. So in this case, when we have a two-way interaction, we have something like this. That is, apart from b1 x1 and b2 x2, we have an interaction variable which is called x1 multiplied by x2. So we have to include, if you have an interaction, that is, these two variables together have some relationship with each other and they are producing some effect apart from affecting individually. Together also they are producing some effect on the output variable, then that is called we have to include the interaction also in the regression coefficient equation. Okay, so here you can see x1 multiplied by x2 is the interaction when we are using a two variable. When we are using more than two variable, for example here, like we are using more than two variables, here we are using a three variable, so we can have a three-way interaction, like we are have a beef, so we are including the interaction like x1 into x2, x1 into x3, x2 into x3 and x1, x2, x3. And with higher order variables, that many order variables we do not consider for interaction, maximum for three or two variables. So this is the interaction. Now how do you know that there is an interaction which exists in your linear regression equation, or you have to consider interaction when you know that? So here interaction plot. So when you are actually, for example, we have two columns, we are considering two columns, like in Boston we consider two columns, RM and LSTAT. We consider these two columns are influencing the target variable the most. So we have included these two columns. How do you know that we have to include the interaction between these two columns or not? Whether there is an interaction. So what does it say? That when you plot the least square regression plot line, if these two columns on the same plot, if you plot these two lines, if they are running parallel to each other, then there is no interaction. So when we have to consider that interaction means in the linear regression equation we are only considered x1 and x2, we are not considering x1 multiplied by x2 also. When we have to consider x1 multiplied by x2 also, so what we do is whenever we are using two variables, for example, whenever we are using two or three variables maximum. When we are using a lot of variables, we don't use interaction because that will give you a very complicated model. So when you are using two variables, if you want to an accurate model prediction, then you have to include interaction if you are having interaction between them. How do you know there is an interaction? So we plot the least squared line of these two attributes on the same graph, and if these two lines are parallel to each other, that means there is no interaction. But if these two lines cross each other or they are not parallel to each other, then you have to include the interaction. So let's see, I have done one. So to understand the potential effect of interaction, compare the lines from the interaction plot. If the lines are parallel, there is no interaction. If the lines are not parallel, there is an interaction. So for example, I had done this with the Boston, and I have plotted the, you can see this L stat as well as RN in the same plot, and this was my graph. So generally the lines are not at all parallel to each other, they are crossing each other. So in this case we have to consider interaction. So we have considered interaction. So what we do is comparing here, what it says, assessing the statistical significance of the interaction term. So comparing the coefficient of determination. What is coefficient of determination? R square. That is called the coefficient of determination. If the interaction term is statistically significant, the interaction term is probably important. And if the coefficient of determination is also much bigger in the interaction term, it is definitely important. So we'll just see this model by considering the interaction term. So here you can see I have included the interaction here. Model 2 equal to LM. MEDV is the price of the house, and RM plus L stat plus RM multiplied by L stat I have considered. I have considered two variables, RM, L stat, plus I have considered the interaction between these two variables, and data I have considered as Boston. And when you have done the summary, you can see the statistical significance of RM into L stat is coming less than 0.05. So that means the interaction is statistically significant, and you have to if you consider this interaction, your model will be more accurate. You can see without interaction, it was my model was coming as around 64. With interaction, my model's R square is coming as 0.74, which is accuracy is much better. If you have any doubts, you can ask. You understood? Yes. So similarly, model without interaction, if I do, you can see the R square. Yeah. Here, so you see multiple R squared value is coming as 63% basically. And there it was coming as 0.74, which is much higher. So that means with interaction, you can assume you can get a higher accuracy. Yes, got it everyone? Okay. So similarly, for example, if I were taking two different variables, L stat and crying I have taken, you see also this is also showing interaction. So like this you can plot. Okay. Next we can consider another attribute, another parameter, which is called multicollinearity. Now, as of now, we were seeing that when we need to do ridge regression, if there is multicollinearity which exists between the two attributes. Okay, multicollinearity means there is some kind of a relationship, either direct or indirect or linear, non-linear, some kind of a relationship between the predictors among themselves. Okay, so in that case, multicollinearity, how do you understand that those predictors who have high multicollinearity, you should not include in your model. Okay, so how do I understand that these are the attributes which have high multicollinearity and I have to remove from my model? So that can be found out by a parameter which is called VIF, or which is also known as variance inflation factor. Variance inflation factor, which is used to understand multicollinearity. Okay, so in multiple regression, two or more, these are only used for multiple regression because we are using multiple variables. Two or more predictor variables might be correlated with each other. The situation is referred to as collinearity. There's an extreme situation called multicollinearity where collinearity exists between three or more variables, and even if no pair of variables has a particularly high correlation. This means there is a redundancy between the predictor variables. Effect of multicollinearity. In presence of multicollinearity, the solution of regression model becomes unstable. For a given factor, multicollinearity can be assessed by computing a score called variance inflation factor. VIF measures how much variance of a regression coefficient is inflated due to multicollinearity of the model. So variance inflation factor should have a range between 0 to 5. More than that, if your variance inflation factor for a variable, it is showing predictor variable, you should remove that from your model. So you can see here, exceeds 5 or 10 indicates a problematic amount of collinearity. So what we do is we can find out the variation inflation factor. See this. So for the variance inflation factor function, you have to include the library car. And here we have included all the data dot I have written, and VIF we have printed of model 1, you can see it is showing me the variance inflation factor of all the models. And here the variables, I think tax and RAD and even, yes, radius and portfolio, something like that. They are having a high VIF. See 7.48, I cannot consider that. Even 9.008 or variance inflation factor, that also cannot be considered. So I have to remove that from my when we are using a model. You can do minus dot minus RAD minus tax, you can do for getting a better accuracy. Okay, so first so you'll do this. Okay, I'm just explaining. After that I'll go to the beginning. You do then least square feet is just what we had done last time. We use LM for the least square feet, but here we have to divide the data into training and testing data and then plot the data. So here you can see the, if you are doing a model, if you want to see the attributes of model 1, you can write attributes model 1 and here you can get all the data. If you want to see the residuals, you can write model 1 dollar residuals. If you want to see the fitted values or the predicted values, you can write model 1 dot dollar predicted values. These are the columns. It is in a array format. And if you want to print this data, see I have written ggplot. We have used ggplot for getting a nice graph. You can use scatter, last time we have used scatter.smooth. That does not require any library, but ggplot requires a library called ggplot2. In case ggplot is not working, you can use scatter.smooth. Okay, if it's working, you can use this. It will give you a nice graph like this. Understood? So let's you open your R and we start from the beginning. Okay, so here library, if it is already there, then also you do it again. Okay, now this is my Boston data set. You want to see the interaction. This is without interaction. I have not included interaction here. Okay, see, this is working. So now what we do is summary model 1. Okay, so this, just note down the value of R square. Here it is 0.6386. Okay, And here you can see both of these variables, RM and ILSTAT, are both statistically significant. They are good variables. Okay, so now what we can do is another model. We are including interaction. 0.63. So now we are doing a model 2 in which we are including the interaction RM multiplied by ILSTAT. And we are doing summary model 2. Now here you can see here this R squared value has increased now significantly. 0.74. If I include all the variables, what happens? Let's see that. So if I include all the variables here, now as you were saying, dot means all the variables. Dot means all the variables. Now, if I do this, I'll see what is the R square value which is coming. Now here you can see here also it is giving 74% R square, and you can see from here some variables are non-significant here, like Indus, whether the house is lying on the bank of Indus or not. Then here age of the house, these are non-significant because there is the p-value is more than 0.05. Have you understood? So they are not statistically significant. You are not doing okay. Statistically significant. So we can remove these two variables, Indus and age, from this model and check whether the model improves or not. So model 4 equal to minus Indus minus age, and we can check summary. Yes, tell me. Here also we are getting 74, means it is not increasing beyond 74. Okay, now we have to print what is the multicollinearity. Multicollinearity, we'll check the multicollinearity. Now this model 4, we are getting a good accuracy, no? For this model 4, what is the accuracy we are getting? Model 4. Suppose we are getting an accuracy of 0.774, that is 74%, consider. So now I want to see multicollinearity of this. For that I need a package called CAR, okay, library CAR. If you don't have CAR, you can install from here, write CAR here. From the RStudio you have to write CAR and click on install. I have CAR, so I'll just write library CAR. Okay, now I want to check the variance inflation factor as it determines multicollinearity. Variance inflation factor is a parameter which determines multicollinearity. It should be less than 5. For an attribute, it should be less than 5. So if it does not have multicollinearity. So VIF, we are considering model 4. Now here we can see, do we have something more than 5? Yes, we have. You can see RED and tax, these two variables we have which are more than 5. So I am going to remove these two variables also from this model. So I am considering model 5 equal to, now previously in model 4 what models we had removed? Indus and age. Now I am including two more variables. So I am using backward selection method, okay. Two more variables I am removing here. RAD and tax. So model 5 is equal to summary model for everything. We got a less R square after removing this two. Got less R square. Okay, we need to remove this crime also. It also does is of no significance. Let's do this. Okay, now we are continuously checking the R square value. There is another way to check the prediction actually. What is the way? We have to first use prediction. This is the model. This is the model accuracy, R square. There is a correlation between actual and prediction value. We have another way to check the prediction, which is called mean max accuracy. Okay, mean max accuracy. That is also used for checking prediction. Okay, anyway, you have understood now how to do the model improvement, trying to do model improvement, and you have to use a model which gives you the maximum accuracy. Okay, so now let's divide this data into training and testing set, and we'll just plot the least square model. So how to do divide the data into training and testing set? It's simple. We have done it earlier also. Sample. Let's take 50-50, 50% training, 50% testing. What do you say? Or we take 80% as we already take, always take. With 80%. Okay. Now, train data is equal to Boston. So first is the number of rows, then is the number of columns. The S is dynamic here, and it is chosen by 80% of the rows which are there in Boston are chosen for training and for testing. Minus S. Okay. Now let's do this everyone has done till VIF variance inflation factor okay car is not done plot this, but here y is equal to MEDV, where x is equal to, we'll take what we have chosen in model 5. Okay, or model 4 was giving us the maximum. it's a dot is not considering it. Here you have to write everyone then one by one. RD Milstat.
Object filler not found, right?
Yes, because dot cannot be used in ggplot. So use the coefficient, no? Here it is written. What are the coefficients we are using? Zn plus chas. These are the name of the attributes. Plus nox. Plus pt ratio. Plus black. Plus CRIM. What is this tab? See, this one. These variables. There are many variables which are out from the training this data set. Let's do data. Let's do train data. Train data liya na maine. See the train data. This was the plotting with the training data, which is quite, I won't say it is very good plot, because there's some plot points are really far from this line. If you do this plot for with the testing data, let's see what it gives. Test data. It looks better with the test data actually. Okay, so this is this ggplot, this function or plotting, we are doing it along with the creating the model here only in the same function without creating a model beforehand directly here, because here we are using this method equal to lm to create the model. One plot we had done with the training data, another plot we have done with the testing data. You can do it on the same page, same line, same plot also with two different colors. That will show you the graph and how the graph is with the training and how is it with the testing. Anyway, this is the least square plot. This is your output for least square plot for this model. And if you do this model, it is... Let's do this model. Model 6 consider equal to LM. I'm using same thing which I have used here, MEDV, and I'm using tilde and vary, and predictors are RM plus LSTAT plus ZN zone plus CHAS plus NOx plus PT ratio plus black plus CRIM, crime. These are the, this is my model, and data is equal to, instead of Boston, I am writing train data. Okay. If I do a summary of model, model 6. Accuracy is coming 69%. Okay, accuracy of this model is coming as 69%, but we'll do prediction. Let's see. P equal to predict on the testing data. So this is my model. Model is model 6. And I have the test data. This is my test data. Where okay, this prediction happened. Now what we do, we once we do this prediction, we print here. We are not printing the confusion matrix. This is not class, no. So we will print the actual and the predicted value. So we take a variable p equal to c bind data dot frame, I think. You convert this C bind will create an array, and you convert that into a frame. Yeah. Then what you can do, you can print this A underscore P. Instead of A underscore P, you can also print head A underscore P, because it has got a lot of data. So this is the actual value and the predicted value. Okay. Now for getting the accuracy of this data, we have a we have another algorithm which is called mean max accuracy. What is mean max accuracy? Mean, this is a formula. Mean apply, this is the your data frame A underscore P. Means for every row you have to find the mean and what minimum value divided by the maximum value, you find the ratio and you do the average of this. That will give you this will give you the accuracy of this data set. The accuracy of the prediction is 85% according to this mean max accuracy. Likewise, you can do for all the models, you can apply this mean max accuracy and check. Ye kya tha? This one only you have done. Phir 68% kaise aa sakta hai? See, I'm doing with the model 5 also. Let's see how much it gives me. Model 5 is giving me more accuracy. It is giving me 87% accuracy. So you can do with all the models and check which one is giving you more accuracy. This is model 5. You can see that it's quite accurate. You can see 18.2 is 18, 14.8 is 15, 24.7 is 22. It's quite accurate. Actual and predicted value. Now we do it with model 1 also. Okay. Model 1, model 2, whatever models you have done now, you can do the prediction with all the models and check which one is giving you the maximum prediction. Good prediction. Then that model you are supposed to use. So we have to do these two regressions. One is ridge regression, another is lasso regression. Okay, the formula for sum of the squares, sum of the squared errors are y minus mean of y square. This we need to minimize. Y minus mean of y square plus lambda into square of the slope. That is for ridge regression. For lasso regression, that same thing becomes y minus mean of y square plus lambda multiplied by absolute value of the slope. This is the so in least square line, what we have, only we want to minimize y minus mean of y whole square. This we need to minimize. But here in ridge regression and lasso regression, we are adding a penalty along with that. So y minus mean of whole square, apart from minimizing this, we have to minimize lambda multiplied by slope square. Slope is the m, value of m which you have. Okay, and here for lasso regression, the same thing. Instead of slope square, we are multiplying with lambda, is multiplied with the absolute value of the slope. I told you both what is the significance of both, that when we are minimizing this data, when we are minimizing the data, for example, we change the value of lambda. When we want to minimize this whole parameter, okay, this sum of the squares error. So if we increase the value of the lambda, the slope has to decrease. If the slope of the line decreases, the line becomes more and more flat. In that case, we are introducing bias in the line, so that the line gets less, line instead of being overfitted to the training data, becomes less fitted to the training data and more fitted to the testing data. That's how we are introducing the bias. And here in the advantages of using lasso regression is, here because you are using the absolute value of the slope, when we increase the value of the lambda, the slope slowly decreases and goes towards zero. So in this case, some of the coefficients, some of the variables which you have used, their slopes become equal to zero and they become eliminated from the data set only. Okay, so that lasso regression can be used for feature selection. So let's see how we can use this. So here in ridge, there is two libraries are there. One is this library, ridge, for using ridge regression. Apart from that, we have one common library called glmnet for both lasso and ridge regression. Okay, so for ridge regression, you can include this library ridge. We can use the model 6 so that we can compare whether the model improvement is happening or not. Okay, last time we have done the model 6, so use the same model 6 with that model if you do it, and we can check that this is the model improvement happens or not. RIDG and put install. So let's take this model 5, okay, and we check the summary of this model. This was the same model. Now I'm going to use the ridge with the same model. So let's do a model 6 equal to, you have to write linear ridge. First include the library ridge. Include this library ridge. Linear ridge, and we do the same thing which we have done in model 5 so that we can compare the models. Okay, okay, here we need a training and testing data for sure. So I cannot write data.boston. Can you use a, have you done the training and testing here? I'll just check. I've opened a new instance, so I don't know. Train data, it's there. This was the thing which we were doing last time. I think you should memorize the code now, by now. Doing mean value, mean max accuracy, no? It's not there. This was giving me 85%. This model was giving me. Now I want to use ridge regression with the same model. So the formula is linear ridge. Apart from that, everything remains the same. You only use this. R is capital, L is small. Do the same set of steps now. Only thing, I use the new model. So very little improvement. 85.7 was the first and this was 85.9. But there was an improvement. Yes. Yes. So we see there is a little bit of improvement, but in the ridge regression. Now, what we want to do is here we cannot see the values of lambda, what we have used in, what is the value of the slope we have used. So let's check the summary of this model. You can see if I do the summary of this ridge regression, it shows me this. If you want to see what are the attributes which I have, because I want to see the value of lambda. Ridge, model ridge, I think. Okay, here you can see there is a value lambda. So what we can do is, if I want to see the value of lambda, so what we have used in this model, we'll use more than one value of lambda, and after that whichever is the optimized value and which is giving me the greatest accuracy is being used here. So if you do dollar lambda, you can see these are the values of lambdas used. So how many lambda values are used? 6 times iterations are done for getting the perfect ridge regression line. So here you can see if you check the comparison of these two models, ridge parameter is given, chosen automatically, computed using 7 iterations. So because you can see there are 7 values of lambda which were chosen, and here we are getting, here when I did at home, the model which I had used, in that I was getting, in normal linear model I was getting 83% accuracy, in the linear ridge model I was getting 84% accuracy. Okay, so there was an improvement, subsequent improvement. Next is, you can do cross validation using linear regression, and you can add your own lambda values. So how we can do that? We can use this lambdas to try, and we can put a random sequence. You can say 10 to the power sequence is starting from -3 to 5, and there is an interval of 100 in between. That is, the meaning of this is -3 to 5, and there is an interval of 100 in between. This is the meaning of this. Okay, so we can check with this, and after that we have to use this library called GLMNet. GLMNet is used both for ridge regression as well as lasso regression. Both can be used. Only the parameter of alpha, you can see here alpha. Alpha is, if you are using ridge regression, you use alpha equal to 0. If you are using lasso regression, you use alpha equal to 1. Okay, so if you have used this training and testing set, have you done this lambdas to try? Use this lambdas to try. Use this value. This is the value of random variables from now of lambda. So for this, you install a package called GLMNet. My package is already there, so it is saying that it is in use and will not be installed. So if it is used, library GLMNet, you do. Then we are using some values of lambda. Random values. So GLMNet you have included. Now GLMNet, it doesn't, we'll do the training and testing data once, because your everyone's answer is coming different, no? So this lambda, these are the lambdas which we are using here for cross validation. These lambdas we are using for cross validation. If you want to see the values of these lambdas, you can check. These are the values of lambdas which will be used for cross validation, tenfold cross validation. Okay, now what we are doing, I am doing the training and testing set data part again. Okay, so I am just doing the sampling. Sample. Okay, before that I will just do set.seed. this will keep my sampling, it won't change dynamically.
Linearly doesn't require choosing lambda.
Which one?
Linearly.
No, automatically it chooses. This is using, we are using cross validation. That's why we have to give up our own. When you do summary, it will show you the here. See, when you do summary, it shows automatically chosen. Have you done summary? Chosen automatically. Okay. So now here what we are doing, training data. Okay, samples, yes. S equal to sample. Now your answer and my answer should be same because we have used seed. Okay. Now GLMNet, it takes the data in the not in the form of this form, not in the form of a data frame. It takes the data in the form of matrix. Okay, so you have to convert this data in a matrix format. GLMNet does not take the data like this, like TR data and test data. If you give in GLMNet function, it won't take that function. So you have to convert this data into matrix. I have already converted. I'll just show you the functions. See here. AS dot matrix train data. See, X is equal to here. I am having X is equal to all the data minus 14, because minus 14 is the output class, so that I don't require in the train data. Okay, and Y equal to AS dot matrix 14, means 14 is the attributes which is used for the dependent variable for prediction, which we need to predict. So here we'll write the same thing. So we are converting this data into matrix format. So X equal to AS matrix. All rows minus 40. That is what we are saying. And Y equal to minus 14 is the column number. Minus 14 is MEDV. MEDV is the column minus 14.
So why are we excluding that?
We won't give that here in X. X is the matrix which is just the use for training apart from
so
the output class. It is. We had done
function
using
like
last time. We had done in KNN. And you remain. We are using the output class separately. We are giving it in the function. Here we are giving the data except the output function. Okay, so output function is stored in the 14 column. So that we are excluding from the training data. And here in the Y, we are, X is the X axis. X axis may we are getting only predictors, no? And in the predictors, there is no output class. Yes or no? In the predictors, there is output class? No, no. Y is the output class, so that we are keeping it here. Train data, TR data. Here, 40. So this is the training data. Now what we are using? We are using the GLM function. So here you can write the model. This is a model name. Any model name you can write, okay? CV is for cross validation. CV dot GLM net means cross validation. X comma Y. Alpha equal to 0 means ridge regression. Alpha equal to 1 means lasso regression. Lambda equal to lambdas to try or lambda underscore nd which we have used. Standardize equal to true. N folds means number of folds. Cross validation we have studied, no, cross validation, how to do cross 10 fold cross validation. We are dividing the data into 10 different sets. First we are using 9 sets as training and 1 for testing. Again we are doing excluding that set which we have used for testing, that we are including in the training. Another data fold we are using for testing. Like this we are doing it multiple times, okay? N-fold cross validation. So that only we have done. See here, have you written the code? Okay, I'll write. So ridge model equal to CV dot was a ridge model. Okay, now if you plot this ridge model, you can see we can get a graph like this. Now see this graph. This graph shows we have the mean squared error on the Y and the lambda on the X. So as the value of, you can see first the lambda is constant, so we have a minimum value of lambda at around point somewhere here, minus 0.5 or something. Here there is a minimum. After that, as you increase the value of the lambda, error is increasing. So we have to use some value of lambda over here in this range only, in the minus range only, because there only the error is less. Mean squared error is less. But here the error, the increase of the error is not very steep. It is slowly, it is increasing. You can see the increase, the error is increasing with lambda very slowly and uniformly. And after that it becomes constant. If you do the same thing with the lasso regression, because why error is increasing slowly? Because the slope, it is slope square, no? So because there is a square component, slope is reducing slowly. But in lasso regression, because you have given absolute value of the slope, it will reduce drastically. So if you see the graph of the lasso regression, let's see, do the same thing with lasso model. And here we write alpha equal to 1. The same thing we are using. And if you do the plot of the lasso, you can see the plot. Suddenly there is a steep increase in the error. And after that it becomes constant. Check the attributes of this. This is the fitness GLM net fit shows the predicted values. These are your Sorry. This is degree of frequency. What is going on? These are the predicted values. These are the predicted values. A0, $A0. Achha, in the GLM fit also we have so many attributes, so many columns. So $A0 shows the predicted values. Wait a minute, let me see I can print this or not. Yes, you are asking something. Achha, $A0. This is the predicted values, okay? So if you want to predict, I think you have to use this with the if you directly use Lasso model with test data, it won't give you the answer, because your predicted values are stored here only in $A0. Actually, I have not done the predicted at home, but let me check. This predict you don't, because we are already getting the predicted value, so you just do cbind data dot frame cbind. This error I'm getting actually, like you were getting that time. So I have to actually check whether this is correct or not. So this one is the predicted values. Because I have not given the column names, actuals and predicteds I have not written, it has taken as x1 and x2. So this is the predicted values, 22.42, actual value is x2. We have two more models. We have one PCR model, principal component regression.